guys ready for tonight? All right. How many of you guys have enjoyed this series? Yeah, it's been awesome. So tonight we have a very special guest. All right, we have Miss Carmen Price coming in the house. Can we give it up for Miss Carmen? Yes. Let me tell you a little about Miss Carmen. Woo! All right, this is Miss Carmen Price. She is our state youth director. So all of the state events that you go to, whether it be camp, whether it be Omega Conference, she is the one that puts it all together. All right, can we give it up for her one more time?
Thank you so much. I'm so excited to be here. And thank you, Pastor Austin. Y'all are very blessed with an awesome, awesome youth leader. And I remember watching him when he was the age of some of you guys in sitting in this room and watching him worship and thinking, man, God is going to do something awesome with this kid. And now look what God has done. It's just amazing to me. So, as he said, me and my husband are the youth directors. We are camp coordinators. We direct a camp. We're very involved in the North Carolina Church of God of Prophecy. He wanted me to tell everyone hello. He works third shift, so unfortunately he was not able to come with me. This is our lovely daughter. She loves when I embarrass her over there. Aww. That's Abigail. She is taller than me, and she is only 12 years old. Those are the two questions. Are you sure she's only 12? Yes. Is she taller than you? Yes. And not only is she only 12, she just turned 12 in March. So, like, she's brand new 12. And so I'm glad that she got to come with me today. I'm very thankful for that. So I just want to pray before we get started. Is that okay? Father, I just thank you for the opportunity to be here in your house today, God. I thank you for the spirit that we already feel here, God, that you are welcome in this place, God, and you have come in already, Lord. We pray that you will have your way, God. Hide me behind you in your cross. Let them hear you today, God. Bind any distractions that may be in the house today, God, so that we can fully focus on you and your word. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, so when Austin, let me just say this. I told y'all I've known him for a really long time, so I'm not disrespecting him when I call him Austin, okay? He is Pastor Austin, but we go way, way, way back. And when he called and asked me about this and told me about the series, immediately I was like ready to give him who I wanted to talk about. And I was like, oh, back up. I got to pray about this first, right? But I have people in the Bible that, like, I read the book of Esther at least twice a year, every year. Hannah is one of my go-tos all the time. I love to talk about Hannah and how she insisted and would not and was so persistent in her prayer life. And I was like, oh, I could do Hannah. And then I was like, oh, wait, but then there's David. And, you know, there's certain ones that just kind of stick out to me personally that I relate to that I would be very comfortable speaking to y'all on because I've spent lots of time studying them and their lives and where they are in the Bible. And so I told him, I was like, let me get back to you on who I'm going to speak about because I want to take the time to pray. And so I began to pray about it, and I was at a women's conference, and God spoke very plainly to me that I needed to speak on Jacob. And Jacob's story actually covers a few chapters in Genesis. So we're going to go to the very beginning of the Bible. And he is in what we're going to talk about from chapter 25 all the way through to 32. So who wants to read that for me? Chapter 25 to chapter 32, anybody? We're gonna give y'all the condensed version, okay? We're not gonna stay here till tomorrow. But I'm gonna read certain scriptures, but you're gonna get the New Living Carmen translation on part of it, okay? So we're gonna start in chapter 25. And in this very first one, and I think we've got slides, is that right? Give it up for Gabby, because she's awesome. So the very beginning of Jacob's story, he was, before he was ever here, his parents were praying for him to be here. They were begging God for a child and pleading with God for a child. And I'm going to go to verse 21. That's where we're going to start in chapter 25. And it said, Isaac pleaded with the Lord on behalf of his wife because she was unable to have children. The Lord answered Isaac's prayer, and Rebekah became pregnant with twins. We can just stop and have church right there because he asked God for a child, but what did God give him? Two, right? Isn't that just how God works? Like, we ask for the least when he's available and ready to give us so much more. And so they were praying for children. God blessed them, and they gave them twins, okay? So they're pregnant, and this is their promise, okay? So they start out as a promise. They were promised to their parents, and here they are. But the problem is, how many of you have a brother or sister? I know yours. You can raise both hands. All right. How many of you love your brother and sister all the time and never fight? The lies. Don't you raise your hand in it. Like every now and then, right? Even the most perfect brother and sister relationship, there's a little argument that happens, right? You've got the best brother in the world, Mallory, don't you? So, we all have issues with our brothers and sisters, right? That's just what happens. This was true for them from the womb. There was a sibling war that began, and it began literally while they were in their mom's belly. They were fighting and fussing and kicking, and then it comes time for them to be born, and they're fighting on the way out. This relationship was doomed from the beginning, right? You thought that you had problems with your siblings, like being too long in the shower and using all the hot water. They were fighting from the womb, okay? So the first one born was Esau, and I'm sorry, I'm from Nash County, so everything's going to sound a little more redneck than it does in Fayetteville, okay? So Esau comes out, and he's like this hairy red baby, okay? But when he's born, Jacob was literally grabbing a hold of his heel because he was fighting to be the first one out. Because in the generation that they grew up in, there was this thing called birthrights that was so important, okay? The first one born, the first son born, was the one that got everything. They got the blessing of the father. They got all of the animals, all the land, all the... So they, the first one born was the one that had the most weight, right? They got the most blessing and the most promises. And so here we are, and they're fighting to come out first. Esau comes out first, and then Jacob comes out. But then Esau got hangry. Anybody ever get hangry? So Esau come home. He had been hunting in the woods. Come home and he was hungry. And he was so hungry that he was willing to give up his birthright for a pot of soup. Have you ever been that hungry? That you were willing to sacrifice everything just for a pot of soup? I ain't never had no soup that good. I'm just going to be honest with you. Like the best soup ever. It'd still be hard to do, right? And so he was like, come on, I'm starving. You're just going to let me die. You know, there's always the one dramatic brother or sister, right? I'm not going to let you guess which one's which. It's not you, I'm sure. But there's always one that's super dramatic. And he's like, feed me, or I'm going to die right here. You're going to let your brother just die. And so Jacob sees this opportunity, right? He's like, okay, well, if you're really that hungry, if you'll give me your birthright, you can have the whole pot if you want it. I'll cook for you. I'll do the dishes, you know, making it look sweet, right? But all you got to do is just give me your birthright. It's not a big deal. And, you know, we're sitting here saying, that's crazy. Like, I ain't never been so hungry that I'd be willing to give up my whole future, right? But if we're honest, our flesh has won that battle many times. Where we're so hungry for other things because we feed our flesh more than we do our spirit, that we're willing to give up the promises that God has given to us to pursue something that God doesn't have for us. We're willing to let go of what he's already said is ours just for a moment of pleasure. And that's exactly what happened here. His flesh was willing to give up his promise. And see, I don't know if you know this, but if we go to the next slide, Jacob actually means deceiver. So straight from the womb, he was named and spoken over as a deceiver. And he started that fight straight away, right? He was trying to be the first, even though it wasn't him that was supposed to be first. He tricked his brother into giving him his birthright. And then we keep going forward, and he's about to trick his own dad. His dad's vision is failing. He's old. He was an old man when he was born. So he's really old now. And he's dying. He can't see well. And him and his mom come up with this genius plot to put fake hair on his arms and to make him smell like he had been outside all day. And go in and tell his dad, before you die, bless me, Dad. I'm Esau, right? And so his dad had to literally touch him and smell him to see that it was him because he couldn't see. And so he blessed Jacob, thinking he was blessing the correct child. So he went in and willingly took his brother's promise. And what that did was leave Esau begging. He come back for the scraps, right? He come in and he's like, oh, Dad, I know you didn't just do that. That was not me. Bless me. Please, 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 please. Bless me, bless me, bless me. But he had already given up his promise. He had already decided that there was something to him that was worth more in that moment. And now he's looking back saying, what have I done? Isn't that what sin does to us? In that moment, it looks so good and like it's what we need and it's what we want and it's we have to have it right then. And then the next day or the next week, we're looking back and we're like, oh, so-and-so's getting blessed at church and I'm sitting back here like, Why isn't this for me? Why is God not talking to me? Why are they getting recognized for this and I'm being pushed to the side? Why did I give that up? He's questioning everything that he did in that one moment. But isn't that what sin is most of the time? The first time, it's a moment. It's a decision. It's something that we decided was worth more than our eternity. But we didn't think of it like that because we were so hungry, right? So he begged Dad for something, and he had to give him what he had left, which was nothing like what he had before, right? He said he was going to have to work hard, and he was going to be in the worst part of the land, and this, that, and the other. And so then he gets mad, and he plots to kill his brother. See, I love the Bible. Because it's better than any soap opera you could ever watch, right? I'm going to kill my brother now. He took my birthright. And so it's so dramatic. And so he's like, you know what? That's fine. If I kill him before my dad dies, then I can have everything that was mine, right? So he's trying to fix it himself. We do that all the time, right? Well, if I can just get Pastor Austin to say that I can do this and I'll be closer to God then, or I'll just go to Pastor Bill and I'll say, can I volunteer to be a greeter today, or whatever I got to do just to get a little bit closer. And we try to do it on our own instead of surrendering to God. So he decides that he's going to kill his brother. So his mom hears that. She warns Jacob. Jacob takes off and hides. And then he has a dream. So we're in Genesis 28 now. And Jacob is asleep and he has a dream. And in this dream, he shows him all these great things. He shows him that he went up a stairway. He was in heaven and looking down on earth. He saw angels going up and down a stairway. And at the top of the stairway, there was God, and God was telling him, you know, the blessings that were on your grandfather Abraham are on you, and you're gonna have as many children as there is dust in the earth, and you know, just telling him all these things that he's gonna be blessed with. And so Jacob's reply, the next morning, he got up early. Let me see, y'all. It went back. He got up and he said, you know what, God, if this is you, then you protect me, you provide food for me, you do this, you do that, and then I'll know that this was really you. How many times do we do that? Like, we'll be sitting here in worship and God will say, why don't you go pray for Austin? And we're like, I know that wasn't for me. Like, somebody, because you know the devil's going to tell you to go pray for somebody, right? So, somebody else can do that. Like, that's my youth pastor. Like, I'm not worthy to go pray for my youth pastor. Like, he should pray for me, right? And we talk ourselves out of it. Well, God, if that's you, then let him look at me and wink, right? Or something crazy. Like, if that's you, let him trip over your shoe. You know, that's just because y'all want to see him fall, but that's okay. But we come up with these negotiations with God, right? Well, I'll do that if. Well, I'll give up that college that I want to go to this college if you make my best friend be my roommate and you make sure that I get the best dorm on campus and make sure my boyfriend comes with me. And so we start negotiating with God. Yeah, I'll do what you want me to do if you do it my way. And that's kind of where Jacob was. He was like, okay, God, if this is you, like if this is you're really promising me these things and you want me to go here and do this, I'm going to need you to make sure that I have plenty of food and that I'm safe and, you know, that you're with me always. And so he immediately goes to the questioning. Because that's usually, if we're being honest, the process. Most of the time when God says, go jump over something, we don't take off running. That's just reality, right? We're like, jump over what? Well, let's pray about it for a little bit, Lord. Let's talk about it a little bit longer, right? Instead of just going full force for what he's asked us to do. And that's where he was. But God is so good. God is so good that literally for the next 29, 30, and 31, the next three chapters, he walks in the favor of God. He is blessed. He has animals, he has land, he has women, he has children. When you lived back then, that was blessed. The more land you had with the more goats and the more, you know, lambs and sheep you had and the more women and the more children, and that was blessed back then. And he just continued to be blessed. And so here he is and he's been all this time and God's been blessing him. And then he hears that his brother is coming and there's a standoff. Now he's being reminded what his name really meant, right? He's being reminded, hey, wait, you're being blessed, but you're a deceiver. You tricked your brother. You stole his birthright. You tricked your dad. And so Satan is bringing back everything that he did wrong. Isn't that how he does to us? Everything you've ever did wrong, as you grow closer to the Lord and you grow in favor, he starts to remind you of everything you did wrong before then, right? Oh, you think you're worthy to get up there and open up service? But we know. Oh, you think you're worthy to get up there and sing on the worship team? But what about 2 years ago when? Right? Because if he can get that little bit of doubt in our mind, just that little bit, because this is really where we fight the hardest. This is where our battlefield is at all times. It doesn't matter if you've been saved for 42 years or you've been saved for 42 minutes. It's a battle in your mind all the time for what's right and what's not and what voice you need to listen to and what you don't. Because Satan is loud. This world is loud. They are pushing everything they can on us, at every angle they can on us, at every place we go. And if we do not know how to discern the voice of God, it's going to be louder than that still small voice that we got to listen for. And so we have to learn how to shut out that voice and know the promises of God. The only way to do that is to know the word, right? Like if you want to know what God has promised you, open your Bible. He's promised you a hope and a future. He's promised you that you are the head and not the tail. But if we don't know the word, we don't know what he said about us. And so we don't know how to combat what's going on in our head. So here he is. He hears that his brother is coming, and he's going to have to stand face to face with the one he deceived. And he freaks out. He's like, oh, no, what am I going to do? So he gets up all his people, and he's like, go take horses and take goats and take women and meet him down there before he gets to me. And give him some of my stuff and see if that makes him happy. And they come back and they report and they're like, there were 400 men with him. And you know, his people are working it up even more, right? And so there's a standoff and he's got to decide, what am I going to do? is this where I'm going to die, right here by the hand of my brother? But we're going to get to my favorite part, and this is the part that we're going to focus on right here. And it was the wrestling match. Does anybody in here wrestle at school? Okay, so you know that any of y'all ever been to a wrestling match at school? Not the ones on TV, that's fake. We're talking about the real stuff. Yeah? There you go. So we, you know, the whole idea is we've got to pin our opponent, right? And so the wrestling match can be as quick or as long as you're willing to fight, right? What it usually comes down to is who gets tired first. Who gets tired first and can't push their shoulders up anymore. So here he is, and he went, and my favorite part about this is he was with all these people. He was with his wives and his kids and the people that were following him, and he went off to be alone. Because sometimes we have to separate ourselves from other people, right? There's sometimes where, like Elise did tonight, she's like, you got to move outside of where you're comfortable. You got to move away from the people that distract you, and you got to put your focus on the Lord, right? And so he went off to be by himself, and an angel appeared. And so this is going to be in chapter 32. And I'm actually going to read this part. It said, during the night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two servant wives, and his 11 sons and crossed the river with them. After taking them to the other side, he sent over all his possessions. Then he left, this left Jacob all alone in the camp. And a man came and wrestled with him until dawn began to break. When the man saw that he could not win the match, he touched Jacob's hip and wrenched it out of socket. Then the man said, let me go, for the dawn is breaking. But Jacob said, I will not let go unless you bless me. What's your name? The man asked, and he replied, Jacob. Your name will no longer be Jacob, the man told him. From now on, you will be called Israel, because you have fought with God and man, and you have won. See, there's several things about this part. This is the part right here, right? So he's wrestling with this man who he realizes as he's wrestling, man, this is an angel. This has come from God. Like, I'm wrestling with God right now. And the angel literally touches his hip. And it says later that he walked with a limp the rest of his life after this. But he refused to let go until what? What do you say? I'm not letting go until you bless me. See, this is different right here. This was different than his dream, right? In his dream, he's like, okay, God, I'll go if you do this, this, and this. But now he's actually having an encounter. He is encountering God, and he has a decision to make. Am I going to walk away the same way that I was when I encountered this man, or am I going to walk differently when I'm done? And see, this is where we struggle sometimes, because we can come to church and we can worship and we can snot and cry and do like everybody else, right? Because we can cry on the altar and we can cry watching a movie. But if we truly encounter God, there's going to be a change. When we truly encounter him, when he really touches us, we're not going to walk the same, we're not going to talk the same, we're not going to look the same. Because when we truly encounter him, we seek holiness after that. When we refuse to let go until he blesses us, then he won't let us down. That's what I love about God. When we encounter him, we never walk the same. And the thing is, we never stop needing encounters. No matter how old we get, no matter how far in life we get, whether it's not just middle school and high school, that we need to encounter God. You're going to go through the things in your life in seasons until you're not here anymore. And so we all need these encounters. And when he encountered him, he said, what is your name? He knew who he was. But he wanted him to hear him say who he was. Who are you? I'm a deceiver. That was his answer, right? Because he said he was Jacob. He said, I'm a deceiver. He said, oh, no, you're not anymore. How many lies have been spoken over you? By other people, by yourself? You're worthless. You're stupid. You're never going to be good at this. You're never going to be good enough. You're never going to reach that goal. You'll never be this. You'll never do that. And if you hear something enough, what do? You start to believe it, don't you? But when we encounter God, he asks us, who are you? And he says, no, sorry, that's not who you are. You're not broken, you're whole. You're not lost, you've been found. He changes everything about us. Can I get like 5 people up here real quick? Just the first 5 that get up here. Yeah, we're so excited. One more? Thank you. Oh, there we go. Okay. All right. So I want all of you to do something for me. Okay. It's going to feel weird, but I just want you to walk back and forth, but I want you to walk like this. Okay. Okay. So they look weird, right? Because we're not used to seeing people walk like this, but... Well, now that he's doing the gritty, that's not so weird, right? We see everybody do that. So, but because they're walking like this and they're all doing it, they're all similar, like none of them are standing out, right? But if, what's your name? Jace. Y'all keep going. If Jace has an encounter that straightens him up and he continues to walk regular, who stands out? Jace does. Now they're hurting and uncomfortable and kind of limping around, but he looks weird, right? In this world, when you encounter God and you walk the way you're supposed to, you're going to look weird to the world. You're going to look different. Thank you. Y'all can have a seat. But if you're willing to do it, guess what? If they kept walking like that every day, they would be in so much pain. Like their back would hurt, and then they'd like overcompensate with their legs. Because have you ever hurt like one leg and then your other leg starts hurting because you had to walk funny because this leg was hurting? Y'all ain't as old as me, so that might not have happened to y'all like it does me. But so, you know, when something's hurting and we use other things in a different way, it makes that hurt, right? When we're broken, then unless we're put back together, we're going to keep breaking. But when God touches you, when you have an encounter, you're going to look like Jace. He looked different than he did when he first came up here, right? But he had an encounter that straightened him up and put everything back together the way it was supposed to be. And then he could walk in a way that he was confident and it didn't hurt and his posture was good and everything was in a line the way it was supposed to be. But he looked weird. He was the weird one. Everybody else was in pain and miserable and could only see the floor, but he looked weird. He could lift his eyes where they couldn't. He could see things that they couldn't see. Because when you're down like this, your head only goes up so far. So if I have my hand up here, I can't see my hand until I straighten up. And I can see it right in my line of sight. I can't lock my eyes on my Savior if I'm walking around broken. But if I'm willing to encounter him and let him put things back together, and if that means that he's got to take this person away or move this out of my life, or I have to stop living this way, or I got to let go of this habit, or I have to change this, or or my whole path that I've set out for my life goes in a whole different direction, as long as I'm going towards him, I'm going the right way. And this is where God told me to focus with you guys tonight, was that he wants to encounter you. He doesn't just want to be your go-to in time of need. He doesn't just want to be where you run when you're hurt, but he wants to be your every day, first thing in the morning and last thing at night. The thing that you truly hunger for, the thing that you're not willing to give up for anything, no matter what they throw at you, what they ask you to do, no matter how weird they think you are because you're the Jesus freak that walks around with your Bible at school, no matter how strange they think you are because you look different and talk different, and because 2 weeks ago you were out here cussing on the baseball field with me, why do you think you're better than me now? Well, last month you were willing to go to the party with me, why are you not going with me now? Oh, you think you're better than me? Y'all ever heard that? No, I don't think I'm better than anybody, but I've got a Savior who told me that there's a standard that I have to meet. And I'd love for you to still be my friend, but if you have to pull me down to your standards, I can't do it. Because it's so much easier for me to pull a box off of a shelf than to pick one up and put it up there. And so it's going to be a lot easier to be pulled down than for you to pick them up. I have a friend that she tells all the girls when she teaches, Angie tells all the girls, she said, girl, unless he's in diapers, you ain't going to change him. I've been there. A long, long time ago, I was a teenager too, and I thought, well, I'll just get him to go to church with me. You know, he'll come on Wednesdays, and, you know, Pastor Austin will get him all, like, you know, he'll be loud, and he'll see it's fun here, and so then he'll come back, and then eventually I can get him here on a Sunday, but I'm going to pick a Sunday where I know, like, the woman that shouts a lot ain't there, and then we'll go to church together. No, baby, if your first date can't be at the church, that ain't the one for you. Because if he stands beside you or she stands beside you and your arms don't go up in the air like they did when he's not there, that's not the one for you. And it's not just our dating relationship, y'all. That's our friends, too. Because if you want to know what your future is, look at your circle. Look at what you surround yourself with. My grandma always told me, you lay with dogs, you're going to get fleas. Right? So, if you're willing to be around somebody all the time that's cussing and doing things that you know you're not supposed to do, what do you think eventually is going to happen to you? You're going to be singing a song, that word's going to slip out, and you're going to go, did I just say that? Where did that come from? I can't believe that just come out of my mouth. Well, you've only heard it for 15 minutes. Back to back to back to back to back. It's in your head. It's in your heart. It's coming out of your mouth. And so God is calling us to have an encounter. Do y'all mind coming back? He wants to encounter you. And you know what? My encounter is not going to look like your encounter. And your encounter is not going to look like her encounter. And hers is not going to look like hers. Because he has a purpose for every one of us. And you know what? It's okay that mine doesn't look like yours. Because that's what the devil's going to do next. He's like, oh, okay, I can't get you to go back to hanging out with those people. Well, let me get you to start comparing yourself to the people in your church. You definitely don't pray like her. Well, you can't pick up a guitar and play like her. What is your purpose here anyway? Like, you're a pew filler? What are you doing here? Because if I can't trip you up with your friends, I'm going to make you feel like you don't belong in the family of God. But I'm here to tell you that every single one of you, there is a plan and there is a purpose for your life, and that is not smaller than anybody else's. You know, the person that sits in the back and runs the sound, this would be a hot mess without them. But nobody ever, yes, Jackson, nobody ever sees them or thinks about them being back there. But that ministry is probably the most important thing that we have. You don't have to have a microphone, a pulpit, and a spotlight to be used by God. He may call you to be a nurse, so that you can be his hands and feet in a hospital. He may call you to be a teacher so that you can touch and pray over a generation that needs to know that there is hope. Not everybody's calling is going to be standing back here. But there's a calling on everybody. And speaking to the guys in the room, I don't know why, but it always seems to take longer for them to give their yes. Because we got to be tough, right? We can't cry. We can't let them, like, we can't be weak. But let me tell you something. We're all weak. He makes us strong. And we are living in a world that needs to see men of God raise up more than ever before. And I don't know why that God has given me that challenge, probably the last three places that I've spoken, but I feel like He needs men to step up, not when they're 30-something, but now, because one day you're going to be the leader of a home. And you're going to have children that need a dad that shows them how to seek the face of God. And you know, I know that seems way far down the road, but you have to prepare yourself for it now. Because you don't want to wait until you're 20-something and you're getting married and you're freaking out and everything's about to change to say, oh, well, I might need to try this God thing for real. He wants to encounter you today and every day. There's an old church word called sanctification. And all it is cleaning up. And you know, we used to have at camp, it used to be first night you could do salvation, second night you do sanctification, third night you do Holy Ghost, and then you talk about deliverance and being called and that kind of stuff. But then we realized that sanctification is not a one-time thing. Because every day I have to die to my flesh. So every day I have to seek holiness. Every day I have to try to be more and more like Him. And so I feel like we need to enter into a season of sanctification, where we let Him come in and clean up and take away things and burn up things that are not of Him, so that we can truly focus on what He says we should do and where we should be. So I want you to find a place. If, first of all, if you don't know Him as your Savior, tonight's your night. This is your moment. This encounter is going to be one that you will never forget. Because he forgives you of everything. Not just some of the things, not just what you did yesterday, but every single thing you've ever done, He forgives you. And then you know what's awesome about God, and it's hard for us to understand because we're not built like this, He forgets about it. He looks at you like you're a whole new creature. And He said, oh, look at you. You're standing up straight. This is how I designed you to be. Now let's go walk and go further. So if you're not saved, tonight is the night for you to have that encounter. God is calling you now because He's ready to have that moment with you so that He can change your life. But if you're saved, I think all of us have something that we need to lay on the altar. We need to die to our flesh, to our desires, to our, let me fix it, God. I can fix it, Lord. Our control. Some of us need to know that we're not the things that the world has spoken over us, that we're what He has called us to be. But all of us need to get up and walk a little different, right? And so I'm going to ask, as they lead into a song, that you will just find a place and that you will ask God to encounter you tonight.